Hello and welcome everybody to another reading of Babylon Mystery Religion from Jörg Glissmann from YouTube channel Juggler66, Hour of the Truth. We have already arrived at chapter 15 from 21 chapters, and I'm trying to get the reading of this book to an end as soon as possible. Planning already other things also, as you know, always other things in the back. But I want to finish this book and then start another reading, another book, when I finish this one, Babylon Mystery Religion. And also I have to tell you that I'm gonna prepare a kind of a summary and a very interesting video when the last chapter is done about this book and about the author Ralph Woodrow. But for the time being, we have arrived at chapter 15 that is called Lords Over God's Heritage. The highest-ranking men of the Roman Catholic Church, next to the Pope, are a group of cardinals. The Bible says that Christ placed apostles, prophets and evangelists, pastors and teachers in his church, as we can read in Ephesians 4, verses 11 through 13. Quote, "And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ." Unquote. But never in Scripture, never we find any indication that he ordained a group of cardinals. To the contrary, the original cardinals were a group of leading priests in the ancient pagan or sun worship religion of Rome, long before the Christian era. A booklet published by the Knights of Columbus, you know, this is the American branch of the Knights of Malta, called This is the Catholic Church, explains, quote, "In ancient times, the cardinals were the chief clergy of Rome. The word is derived from the Latin word cardo, meaning hinge, and thus referred to those who were the pivotal members of the clergy." Unquote. But why were these priests of ancient Rome linked with the word hinge? They were evidently the priests of Janus, the sun worship god of doors and hinges. Janus was referred to as, quote unquote, the god of beginnings. Thus, January, the beginning month of our Roman calendar, comes from his name. You know, that is Pope Gregory who changed that in the 1600s, in the 16th century, to the Gregorian calendar. He changed the beginning of the year from April to January, and he took out 10 days or something in October, 10 or 11 days. Just the dates, the days themselves continued. Anyway, as God of doors, Janus, he was the protector or caretaker. Think about it. Even today, the keepers of doors is called a janitor, a word derived from the name Janus. Janus was known as the opener and shutter. Because he was worshipped as such in Asia Minor, we can better understand the words of Jesus to the church at Philadelphia that we can read in Revelation 3, verse 7 and 8. Quote, "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, These things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and shutteth, and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name." Unquote. The sun-worshipping god Janus was a counterfeit. Jesus was the true opener and shutter. Jesus is the door. Jesus is the only way. That's what true biblical or Bible-believing Christians believe and follow. Quote, "The College of Cardinals, with the Pope at its head," writes Hislop, is just the counterpart of the SUN Sun Worship Pagan College of Pontiffs, with its Pontifex Maximus, or Sovereign Pontiff, which is known to have been framed on the model of the Grand Original Council of Pontiffs at Babylon. Unquote. When SUN Sun Worship and Christianity, means paganism and sun worship, are mixed together with Christianity, the cardinals, priests of the hinge that had served in the sun-worshipping Rome eventually found a place in papal Rome. The garments worn by the cardinals of the Catholic Church are red. Cardinal birds, cardinal flowers, and cardinal priests are all linked together by the color red. The Bible mentions certain princes of Babylon who dressed in red garments, as we can read in Ezekiel chapter 23, verses 14 and 15, quote, "And that she increased her whoredoms. For when she saw men portrayed upon the wall, the images of the Chaldeans portrayed with vermilion, girded with girdles upon their loins, exceeding in dyed attire upon their heads, all of them princes to look to, after the manner of the Babylonians of Chaldea, the land of their nativity." Unquote. The harlot symbolizing Babylonish religion was dressed in scarlet red garments, as we can read in Revelation 17, verse 4. Quote, "And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication." Unquote. From ancient times, the color red or scarlet has been associated with sin. Isaiah says this in Isaiah 1 verse 18, quote, "Come now, and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." Unquote. Adultery is sometimes referred to as the scarlet sin. The color red is associated with prostitution, as in the expression red light district. So you know the red light district over there in the place where you live probably, and I come from Hamburg. And the funny thing is, the first thing then when you say to someone that you come from Hamburg, whether I say that here in Belgium, where I live now, or you say that in Germany, they say, "Ah, the Reeperbahn." The Reeperbahn is a street in the community of Altona, on the west of Hamburg. And it is also called the Sinful Mile. Die Sündenmeile, as we say in German. And it is the so-called red light district, where you go from one bar to another, and in every bar you are probably approached by a prostitute to have a drink, or even to go with her and to do your thing that people like to do who do not follow the Bible. The red light district. Reeperbahn in Germany, and I guess you have your streets and quarters over there in the United States and in all the other countries where you listen to me right now, that you very well understand that. So the color red is associated with prostitution. Of course, prostitution is a sin. Adultery is referred to as the scarlet sin. And what is adultery? Well, adultery is every sex that you have outside of marriage. That would be a video of himself, I think. But when you really understand the Bible as it was meant to be understood, you know that so-called premarital sex is also adultery. Why? You are not married. So why can't you have premarital sex? Well, because you are not married. So every sex outside of marriage is adultery, is fornication, is a sin. And as the author writes here, is a scarlet sin. I don't make any differences between this sin and that sin like the Roman Catholic Church does. I don't appropriate them with different colors or whatever. But adultery is referred to sometimes as the scarlet sin, and we can see how that is. Anyway, on that marriage thing, I can do a video on my own, and certainly with my experience that I've had from some weeks ago and some months ago. Personal experience. But that's something else. Anyway, the author continues, in view of these things, it does not seem unfair to question why red would be used for the garments of the highest ranking men in the Romish Church. No, it does not seem unfair to question why red would be used for the garments of the highest ranking men of the Romish Church, because they are all fornicators, they are all adulterers, they are all idolaters, and they do nothing else but sin. And surely sexual sin, with the abuse of young boys and young girls, and of course with their sodomy agenda that is all over the world, ramping around. There is not a greater gay community in this world, if you want to call it that, or a sodomite group in this world as Roman Catholic priests, and probably all the other S.U.N. sun-worshipping priests right along with them. We are not saying it is wrong to wear red, yet does it not seem like a curious custom for cardinals? Are we to suppose such garments were worn by the apostles? Or is it more likely that the red garments of the cardinals were copied from those worn by priests of the S.U.N. sun-worshipping Rome? The priests of the Hinge in sun-worship days were known as flamens. The word is taken from flare, meaning one who blows or kindles a sacred fire. They were the keepers of the holy flame, which they fanned with the mystic fan of Bacchus. Like the color of the fire they tended, their garments were flame color, red. They were servants of the Pontifex Maximus in S.U.N. sun-worshipping pagan days, and the cardinals today are the servants of the Pope, say Antichrist, who also claims the title Pontifex Maximus. The flamens were divided into three distinct groups, and so are the cardinals: cardinal bishops, cardinal priests, and cardinal deacons. Next in authority under the Pope, or the Antichrist, and the cardinals are the bishops of the Catholic Church. Unlike the titles Pope and Cardinal, the Bible does mention bishops. Like the word saints, however, the word bishop has been commonly misunderstood. I wouldn't say misunderstood, I would say mistaught and misinterpreted. Many think of a bishop as a minister of superior rank, having authority over a group of other ministers and churches. This idea is reflected in the word cathedral, which comes from cathedra, meaning throne. A cathedral, unlike other churches, is the one in which the throne of the bishop is located. But turning to the Bible, all ministers are called bishops, not just ministers of certain cities. Paul instructed Titus to ordain elders in every city, as we can read in Titus 1, verse 5 through 7, through 9. Quote, "For this cause left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldst should set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city as I have appointed thee. If any be blameless, the husband of one wife," listen carefully, "the husband of one wife." Where is that to be found in Roman Catholics? Well, we probably go into that later. Anyway, verse 6. "If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly. For a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, not given to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate, holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and convince the gainsayers." Unquote. From Titus. And then he went on to speak of these elders as bishops, as we just read in verse 7. So when Paul instructed the elders of Ephesus, he said, quote, "Take heed unto yourselves and to the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers," meaning bishops, "to feed, pastor, the church of God," as we can read in Acts 20, verses 17 through 29. And I'm going to quote this right here from the King James. Quote, "And from Miletus he sent to Ephesus, and called the elders of the church. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, Ye know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind, and with many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in the weight of the Jews. And how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly, and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received after the Lord Jesus, to testify the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that ye all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers," bishops, "to feed the church of God, which he had purchased with his own blood." Unquote. And I even have to add here verse 29, because I think this is very, very important. "For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock." Unquote. The word translated overseers is the same word as that is elsewhere translated bishops. The word feed means the same as the word translated pastor. These ministers were referred to as elders, bishops, overseers, and pastors, all of these expressions referring to exactly the same office. Plainly enough, a bishop in the scriptures was not a minister of a large city who sat on a throne and exercised authority over a group of other ministers. Each church had its elders, and these elders were bishops. This was understood by Martin Luther. Quote, "But as for the bishops that we now have," he remarked, "of these the scriptures know nothing. They were instituted so that one might rule over many ministers." Unquote. Even before the New Testament was completed, it was needful to give warnings about the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, as we can read in Revelation 2, verse 6. Quote, "But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate." Unquote. Now, this is Jesus speaking here. And we are well to understand that he hates the deeds of the Nicolaitans. He does not hate the Nicolaitans themselves. A lot of people in the past, I understood, interpreted this as, "Oh, Jesus hated the Nicolaitans. Aren't you supposed not to hate, but to love everyone?" Well, read it again. "But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate." Unquote. So Jesus hates the same as the person that he speaks to. This thou hast. And thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans. So, when he hates the same thing, he doesn't hate the Nicolaitans, but he hates the deeds of the Nicolaitans. We are not to hate people, but we are to hate and expose their false doctrine. This is what this verse is all about. Now, according to Schofield, the word Nicolaitans comes from Nicoa, to conquer, and laos, laity, which, if correct, refers to the earliest form of the notion of a priestly order, or clergy, which later divided an equal brotherhood, as we can read in Matthew 23, verse 8, into priests and laity. What does Matthew 23, verse 8 say? Quote, But be not ye called rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brethren. So what do we do with all the so-called rabbis in the Jewish community, which is translated master or father or whatever? There's only one father, the one who is in heaven. The word priest in a very real sense belongs to every Christian believer, not just ecclesiastical leaders. Peter instructed ministers not to be, quote, lords over God's heritage, as we can read in 1 Peter 5, verse 3, quote, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being ensamples to the flock, unquote. The word translated heritage is kleron, and means clergy. As the Matthew Henry commentary explains, all the children of God are given the title, quote, the title of God's heritage or clergy. The word is never restrained in the New Testament to the ministers of religion only, unquote. Rejecting an artificial division between clergy and laity, this is not to say that ministers should not receive proper respect and honor, especially they who labor in the word, as we read in 1 Timothy 5, verse 17, quote, let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine, unquote. But because of this division, too often people of a congregation are prone to place all responsibility for the work of God upon the minister. Actually, God has a ministry for all of his people. This is not to say that all have a pulpit ministry, but even giving a cup of cold water is not without its purpose and reward, as we can read in Matthew 10, verse 42, quote, and whosoever shall give to drink unto one of these little ones a cup of cold water only in the name of a disciple, verily I say unto you, he shall not in no wise lose his reward. Unquote. It would be well for each of us to pray, quote, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? Unquote. As we can read in Acts chapter 9, verse 6, quote, and he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, arise, and go into the city, and it shall be told that it shall be told thee what thou must do. Unquote. In the New Testament, the full work of a church was not placed on one individual. Churches were commonly pastored by a plurality of elders, as numerous scriptures show. They ordained elders, plural, in every church, as we can read in Acts 14, verse 23, quote, and when they had ordained them elders in every church and had prayed with fasting, they commanded them to the Lord, on whom they believed, unquote. And also, not only in every church, but also in every city, as we can read in Titus chapter 1, verse 5, as we've read before. Quote, for this cause I left thee in Crete, that thou shouldst see in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city, as I had appointed thee. Unquote. Expressions such as the elders, plural, of the church are commonly used, as we can read in Acts chapter 20, verse 17, and in James 5, verse 14. Quote from Acts. And from Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church. And then James would read, quote, "Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord." Unquote. All who have been washed from their sins by the blood of Christ are priests unto God, and they are a royal priesthood. We can read for confirmation Revelation chapter 1 verse 6, quote, "And hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion for ever and ever. Amen." Unquote. And in 1 Peter 2 verse 9 we read, quote, "But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." Unquote. The priesthood of all believers is clearly the New Testament position. But as men exalted themselves as lords over God's heritage, people were taught that they needed a priest to whom they could tell their sins. A priest must sprinkle them, a priest must give them the last rites, a priest must say mass for them, etc. As men exalted themselves, people were told that they needed a priest. Now, just go to the Bible. Read all the verses that I have cited here in this reading so far, and maybe a little more, and you will see that we are all brethren, we are all alike, and we have one master above us, Jesus Christ, and no other, and no man is there to teach us the things of the Bible. The Bible teaches itself to us. And when reading diligently the right Bible, the Bible will always explain itself. Therefore, it is imperative to have the right Bible. And I do not go again into a discussion of the King James or whatever. Find that out for yourself. If you really have another Bible that explains itself that perfectly as the King James does, and you find really the word of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in that Bible, and find the true belief in Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior, it's fine with me. It's fine with me. But don't forget that all these other Bibles out there are designed to mislead you and to take away the divinity of Jesus Christ, and leaving out verses and even whole chapters. I mean, between the King James and the New King James, you have 6,600 changes, or at least more than 6,000 changes, as far as I remember. So that cannot be the pure Word of God, right? When it's changed 6,000 times, according to the manuscripts, the Textus Receptus. But going back to the article to the paragraph here in the book, as men exalted themselves, people were taught that they needed a priest. Well, when you're a Bible-believing Christian, whose teaching are you to follow? The teaching of man or the teaching of the book, the Bible? Ask yourself that question, and I can stop ranting here in a second. As men exalted themselves, they were taught, let me insert, by men, by priests, by bishops, by cardinals, that they needed a priest to whom they could tell their sins, etc., etc. It is not biblical. So when a person teaches you something, take out your Bible and compare that what the person teaches to you to the Word of God. And is it in accordance with it? Fine, you've learned something, but is it not in accordance? Point out the errors. They were taught to depend upon a human priest, while the true high priest, the Lord Jesus, was obscured from their view by a dark cloud of man-made traditions. The Roman Catholic Church holds tradition much higher than the Bible itself. I was just starting to read another book that is called Roman Catholicism. It's written by Lorraine Bettner. And I'm probably gonna read this book in the future also. And there is something quite interesting in, because it's about a little discussion about using the word Catholic. So my point that I want to make is that because I researched this a little bit, I found something here in this new book, and I made a note on that because of something that Augustine taught. And Augustine taught, for example, that the Catholic Church is the kingdom of God. So that's why I came to this comment here. But the point that I was making right now is that Augustine also exalted the church tradition above the scripture. And here comes a quote from Augustine. Listen carefully. "I should not believe the gospel unless I were moved to do so by the authority of the Catholic Church." End quote. Tradition, right? What did we just read? They were taught to depend upon human priests, while the true high priest was obscured from their view by a dark cloud of man-made traditions. And when these man-made traditions tell you that you are not to believe the Bible, people like Augustine said, okay, I prefer tradition and the teaching and the Gnostic teaching of men above the Word of God. I think I exalted that point far enough, right? Unlike Elihu, the author continues, who did not want to give flattering titles unto men, as we read in Job 32, verse 21, quote, "Let me not, I pray you, accept any man's person, neither let me give flattering titles unto men," unquote. Those who exalted themselves as lords over the people began to take unto themselves titles which were unscriptural, and, in some cases, titles that should belong only to God. That is called blasphemy. They took titles that were out of scripture, and in some cases they took titles that only belong to God. So first of all, in that way they change scripture, and second of all, they blaspheme God by taking titles that are only belonging to our Lord and our Father in heaven. As a warning against this practice, Jesus said, "Call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your Father which is in heaven. Neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even Christ. But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. And whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be exalted." That was a quote from Matthew chapter 23, verses 9 through 12. It is difficult to understand how a church claiming to have Christ as its founder after a few centuries would begin to use the very titles that he said not to use. Really? Is that so astonishing? After a few centuries? Now we only have a few generations, one, sometimes two, at the highest three generations, and people don't know anymore what was being taught earlier and accept the new teaching. What do you think, where do you think comes all the success from Vatican II, the ecumenical Vatican Council of the 60s of the last century, where ecumenism started and charismatic movements started, and it led all the Protestant churches back under the wings of Rome. Within 50 years, we are speaking here, after a few centuries, that they would begin to use the very titles that he said not to use. A few centuries. Today we are down to 25, 40, 45, 50 years at the most. Nevertheless, the Bishop of Rome began to be called by the title Pope, which is only a variation of the word Father. The priests of Catholicism are called Father. We will remember that one of the leading branches of the mysteries that came to Rome in the early days was Mithraism. In this religion, Mithraism, those who presided over the sacred ceremonies were called Fathers. An article on Mithraism in the Catholic Encyclopedia says, quote, "The Fathers, used here as a religious title, conducted the worship. The chief of the Fathers, a sort of pope, who always lived at Rome, was called Pater Patrum." Unquote. Now, if the pagan S.U.N. sun worshippers in Rome called their priests by the title Father, and if Christ said to call no man Father, from what source did the Roman Catholic custom of calling a priest by this title come from? Christ or S.U.N. pagan sun worship? Well, if you cannot answer this question correctly, you do not have the Spirit of Christ in you. And maybe this is a question that you should ask a few Catholic people that you meet out there in the street. I don't want to say brother or sister, because a true Roman Catholic is not a brethren of the body of Christ. But you can always ask questions and listen to their answers. If the sun worshippers in Rome called their priests by the title Father, and Christ said to call no man Father, where do they got it from? Are they then living according to the word of Christ, or to the tradition of their congregation, of their denomination, of their church? You always learn when you ask questions. Even the Bible gives an example of pagan S.U.N. sun worship priests being called Father. A man by the name of Micah said to a young Levite, quote, "Dwell with me and be unto me a father and a priest," as we can read in Judges chapter 17, verse 10, quote, "And Micah said unto him, Dwell with me, and be unto me a father and a priest, and I will give thee 10 shekels of silver by a year, and a suit of apparel, and thy victuals." So the Levite went in. Unquote. Now Micah was a grown man with a son of his own. The Levite was a young man. The title Father was obviously used in a religious sense, as a priestly designation. Micah wanted him to be a father priest in his house of gods. This was a type of Catholicism. For while the young priest claimed to speak the word of the Lord, as we can read in Judges 18 verse 6, the worship was clearly mixed with idols and S.U.N. pagan sun worship. Now, if you're interested, I can go into a whole reading of Judges 18 and read the whole chapter to you. But I'm not going to do this right now, because this is a quite long chapter, 31 verses, and I leave it up to do your own research to read this and understand that in the context that I've read the book Babylon Mystery Religion to you here. Now the author continues that the Roman Catholic Church uses the title Monsignor, which means my lord. It is somewhat of a general title the Catholic Encyclopedia explains, and can be properly used in addressing several of the higher church leaders. Quote, instead of addressing patriarchs as vostra beatitudine, meaning your bliss, archbishops as your grace, bishops as my lord, abbots as gracious lord, one may without any breach of etiquette salute all equally as Monsignor. One of the meanings of arch is master, and master also means head. Using titles such as archpriest, archbishop, archdeacon is like saying master priest, master bishop, master deacon, master cardinal. The superior of the Order of Dominicans is called Master General. And who were the Dominicans? The order who executed the Inquisition. We need only to cite again the words of Christ, which are in contrast to such titles. Quote, neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even Christ. Unquote. But even the title Reverend, which is used for pastors within the Protestant churches, biblically speaking, is applied only to God. It appears one time in the Bible. We read that in Psalms 111, verse 9, but I have to add verse 10 also because I love verse 10. Quote, Psalms 111, verse 10. He sent redemption unto his people. He hath commanded his covenant forever. Holy and reverent is his name. And like I said, I really have to add the next verse here because it's such a wonderful teaching. Quote, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments, his praise endureth forever. Unquote. Now the word reverent comes from the Latin revere, and it was first applied to the English clergy as a title of respect during the 15th century. Variations of these titles are the reverend, the very reverend, the most reverend, the right reverend. And commenting on the use of these very titles, the noted London preacher C.H. Spurgeon said, quote, for myself, I desire to be known henceforth simply as the servant of God, and I want my walk and conversation to prove that I am his servant indeed. If I, the servant of God, am to be esteemed in any measure by my fellow Christians, it shall not be because in front of my name an attribute stolen from God has been placed by an ordaining council, neither shall it be because my collar is buttoned at the back or my coat is clerical and cut, but only for my work's sake. Unquote. When Jesus spoke against flattering titles, the basic thought was that of humility and equality among his disciples. Should we not then reject the supposed authority of those high offices in which men seek to make themselves lords over God's heritage? And instead of men receiving glory, should not all the glory be given to God? All glory giving to God. He is the only who deserves glory, who deserves worship. God, our Father in heaven, and our Lord Jesus Christ at his right hand. Well, this was chapter 15 of Babylon Mystery Religion, and I will continue the next reading with chapter 16 and Unmarried Priesthood. But because I have come already to 45 minutes, I will conclude the reading here. Otherwise, that would be too long. So, I have to comfort you for another reading that you have probably to wait for a few days. But as I said, I will speed up finishing this book within the next month, even in uploading that. So today we have the 29th of June, so at May, so at the end of June, I will have that book completely uploaded on my channel. And as you all know, I've written that and I've said that more than enough. All my work is copyright free, and I would very much appreciate it that if you yourself give this video a thumbs up or like it in any way and share it wherever you can, on Facebook or Twitter or any social media that you are associated with, and even re-upload these readings up to your own channel. I have no problem with that. Just in the description box where you make a link where you got the original from, that is more than satisfying to me. Freely I have received, freely I give. These teachings is my ministry, to read these books and to get people to the knowledge to come out of her, my people, as God says in Revelation 18 verse 4. The more that every man and every woman and every child understands that the Roman Catholic Church hijacked the word Christianity, abuses and misuses it for its own purposes, and it has nothing to do with the gospel of the Jesus Christ of the Bible, the descendant from David, the one who was there even before Abraham, the father of, or the Father God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. The more people will know this and understand this and learn this, the better it is. You all know that we are in the end times right now. So give people a chance. And who is too lazy to read the Bible? Well, he can watch videos like this or just listen to this. To readings of me, to readings of Tom Fress, readings of Jesse Vessel, readings of Brett Norman. All people that I absolutely endorse. Also via my channel. Everybody has his own work to do. Everybody has his own cross that Christ gave him. Everybody has his own burden. Everybody has its own ministry. I'm doing this, Brett Norman is doing something else, Jesse Vessel is doing something else, and Tim Fress is something else. So we are not parrots of one each other, we are all separate, but all doing the work of God in the way that he ordained us to do the work. And I will continue with, in a short time, chapter 16, called An Unmarried Priesthood. I think there will be quite some interesting comments and quite some interesting reading in there. Up to here, thank you very much for watching, for listening. Joggler 66 from Hour of the Truth says goodbye, God bless you, until next time. Bye bye.